for your abundant of grace.
Yes.
Hey, through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we reign, we reign, we reign. Oh God, we thank you for power and authority over all power of the enemy. Nothing by no means shall hurt us. Nothing by no means shall hurt us. Hallelujah. Nothing by no means shall hurt us. Lord, we thank you. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name, the name above every name. Yeah, Lord, we thank you for the victory tonight, for this is the victory. Yes, this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Our faith is the victory, and whosoever is born of you overcometh. For this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Oh God, we thank you tonight. We give you the praise and the glory tonight. Thank you, Lord, for what you have begun in us. The work you have begun in us. The work that you have begun in us. You will continue to perform it. Oh, hallelujah. Have our eyes up on you. Yes, we look to you, the author and the finisher. Oh God, we bless you tonight. Thank you for what you're doing. Give you the glory in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for effectually working in us. We thank you for your spirit that leads and guides. Hey, that goes alongside of us. Yes, keeping us, blessing us, lifting us, strengthening us. Hey, yes. Helping us, God, to overcome. We overcome by your blood and the word of our testimony. Yes, we've been delivered from the power of darkness. This is our testimony. We've been delivered from the power of darkness. We've been translated into the kingdom of your dear Son, in whom we have redemption, oh God. We're redeemed from the curse of the law. We're delivered from the power of darkness. We have redemption through your blood. Even the remission of our sins, according to the riches of your grace. Father, tonight we give you praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, the name above every name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. This is the victory. This is the victory. This is the victory. This is the victory. This is the victory that overcomes even our faith. Hey. Oh, God, our faith is the victory. Our faith is the victory. You've dealt to every man the measure of faith. We give you the praise and the glory. Hallelujah. In Jesus' mighty name, the name above every name, we give you the praise and the glory tonight. In the name, in the name, in the name, precious name, wonderful name, honorable name, the name above every name. Hey, we have dominion through the name. We have power and authority through the name. Hey, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. All that we need is in the name. We give you the praise and the glory tonight. Thank you for your grace, which is sufficient to put us over in this life. Your grace is sufficient, and you're able to cause all grace to abound toward us, so we will have sufficiency in everything. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. Hey, in Jesus' mighty name. We have the victory. We thank you for the victory. We thank you for the victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the victory. This is the victory. Even our faith. Oh God, we stand on the promises of God. Your word will not return void. Your covenant you will not break. You will not alter the word that has come out of your mouth. Your promises are sure to every seed. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you tonight, and we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name. Hey, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen, 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 amen. All right, just wanted to kind of recap some of the things that you might want to write some of these things down that we want to, after having studied chapter, after
after having studied chapter 2, having God's interest in heart, we want to make sure that we have an interest in the lost. Amen. Everybody has an interest in the lost.
Interest in the lost.
There are scriptures that we can certainly give you that will bear me out. So if we don't have an interest in the lost, then that means that it's gonna cost us. Everybody says it's gonna cost us. Amen. But it will cost us in this life, and it will cost us in the life to come. Okay. So there's a scripture in James 1, I believe 18, mentions about how it will cost us. How it will cost us in this life. And in Ezekiel 3, it tells how it will cost us in the life to come. The blessings that God has provided are all contingent upon us keeping his commandments and doing those things pleasing in this life. Everybody understand that?
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to get at the core of God's commandments, that means that we have to be interested in the things that God is interested in. So we definitely want to develop an interest in the laws. Find you somebody to do something with. Follow through, encourage, amen. Teach them how to be saved. Teach them how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. These are all of the things that are necessary in order for us to be successful in winning lost men. All right, I'm sorry. James 1:25, it says that. But whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. This man shall be blessed in his deed. Amen. So if you want to be blessed, it takes more than giving mental assent to the word, hearing the word, and doing the word and getting Bible study. You have to be a doer of the work. Everybody say a doer of the work. Everybody say a doer of the work. The work means that we have to be interested basically in the things that Jesus was interested in. And you can kind of look over your life and just see where you are. Be interested in the things that Jesus was interested in. Okay, so you have to be a doer of the work. It's all about works after you get saved. Is that right? It's all about works. We will be judged according to our what? Works. Is that right? What we receive throughout eternity, the blessings and the privileges and all of the different things that God has reserved for us is going to be contingent upon our works. And our works will come into play. They will be evaluated. Luke 14:14 says, at the resurrection of the just. Amen. When the people, those in Christ, will be resurrected from the dead, that's when we will stand before the judgment seat of Christ and give account of our work. Amen. So this is not a light thing. You know, this is not something that we can play around with. We really have to pray and bring ourselves to the point where we will really begin to take the things of God a lot more serious than we are. Amen. So, turn to that scripture, Luke 14:14. Bible says that God will bring every work into judgment, and we will have to give an account of the deeds done in our bodies. Amen. Luke 14:14 is really easy to remember, 14:14, and this is what it says, and thou shalt be blessed, for they cannot recompense thee, for thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. So there are blessings that you will receive in this life by doing the works, the works that Jesus did. Amen. And basically putting it in a broad way, the works that Jesus did, Jesus was interested in the lost. He was interested in their physical well-being, their spiritual well-being, and he was interested in their eternal well-being. Amen. So he wants people saved. He doesn't want them dying and what? Losing their souls. God has no pleasure in the souls, amen, that die. He has no pleasure in people that die in sin. All right, so he's interested in men's souls. He doesn't want them lost, but he want them what? Saved. Amen. Anybody have any idea what it means? What it will cost us if we die and lose our souls? Amen. I don't think anybody really have a real revelation of how much it will cost us if we fall short of keeping God's word and die, because the Bible says faith without works is what?
Dead.
People that don't do nothing, they're not sincere. They can't please God.
Eternal damnation.
Eternal damnation. Okay. And you don't want, you know, we can get so complacent because, you know, just so many things to distract us from.
Let me add this, okay. If I may. Mm-hmm. We are to be interested in the things of mm-hmm. Jesus was interested in. Mm-hmm. And our focus, you're saying, on getting saved. Mm-hmm. That's the primary. Mm-hmm. That's the first. But secondarily as well, mm-hmm. is sometimes is discipleship, mm-hmm. helping people. Because sometimes if you lead a person to the Lord, mm-hmm. that's good. Mm-hmm. But if you just don't do anything else, mm-hmm. you know, they may fall by the wayside. And in the process of discipling them, a lot of times people have to be encouraged. And then even the people that have been in the way, we say, quote, in the way, mm-hmm. for many, many years, need to be encouraged. And I think that's a part of Jesus, you know, was interested in people, mm-hmm. you know. So it's a multifaceted approach. It's not just...
Well, I would just... Okay.
Right. There are several.
Growing and developing mm-hmm. in their faith right. is a major part, too. I would just say the first part would mm-hmm. be the souls. And secondly, God wants everybody filled with the Holy Spirit. Because filled with the Holy Spirit, you really can't develop and grow and measure up to the work that God has called you to do without being filled with the Holy Spirit. Y'all know what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Y'all know? Okay, that means that the Holy Spirit is just like Jesus being in you, inside of you on a personal basis. Everything that Jesus would do if we were here in person, he can do it through the Holy Spirit now, if we receive the Holy Spirit. He can lead us and guide us and teach us and reveal to us and talk to us. And he can go alongside of us. And he can do everything that needs to be done just by living on the inside of us. And that's what the Holy Spirit's work is, to live on the inside of us and to take the place of what Jesus being here in person. In order for him to take that leadership role and really rule and guide and control your life, then there are certain things we have to do. We have to what? Abide in him, and his word has to what? Abide in us. Right? That means that we have to what? Read our Bibles. Amen. Everybody got me? You got to what? Read your Bible? Because if you don't read your Bible, you can't communicate or hear from God. Is that right? And then you have to pray. That's another way that you can communicate with the Lord, is by through what? Prayer. Is that right? And that's the reason why it's very important for everybody to practice the presence of God. Practice praying in the Holy Spirit. Now, we're speaking about how to build yourself up on your most holy faith, how to grow and how to develop. So through feeding on the Word, praying in the Holy Spirit, and the other facet of it is that you have to what? Do the works that Jesus did. If you pray and read your Bible and never did the works, then you still won't get established in holiness. In other words, you won't be able to live an overcoming life. You got to, amen, you got your works, you got to, or the scripture says, in terms of your works, he says, increase the fruit of your righteousness. That's what it says, and I believe in Philippians 1, 9, 10, or 11. Increase the fruit of your righteousness. Another word, I believe it says, be filled with the fruits of righteousness. And so that's the way we overcome sin, by what? By faith and by works. By faith and by what? Works. That's the way we overcome. Amen. By faith and by works. When people are actively involved in doing the works of Jesus, their minds are going to be focused. Their attention is going to be on what? Heavenly things, right? And then they're not going to be what? So easily distracted. And their attention and their focus will less likely to be changed. Amen. So we want to get at the core of our salvation and understand how important it is for us to what? Be balanced. You know, we need to focus on the unsaved, amen, their well-being, because if we don't reach them, especially when they cross our path, and the Bible says, don't withhold good from them to whom it is what? Do when it's in the power of your hand to what? To do it. So there will be people that God will put right across our path, people that will be easy for us to reach, people that we know that we could what? We could reach if we would just lend a helping hand. All right, so that God will hold us accountable for those people. And if we don't respond to those that God placed in our path, the Bible says God will hold their souls, hold us accountable for their what? Soul. What does that mean, God, for their blood shall be on your hand? When God says that if we don't speak to the lost to save them from death, their blood will be charged to our hands. What does that mean? Yeah, God will hold you what? Accountable at the judgment. Amen. That will be at the judgment seat. If you make it there, if you don't make it there, then you will be held accountable at the white throne judgment. You either will be accountable at the white throne judgment. Everybody know the difference between the white throne and the judgment seat? The white throne judgment is the judgment in which people that miss the mark, people that don't take part in the first resurrection, they will take part in the second resurrection. Is that right? Okay, but our works will all come up at the judgment seat of Christ. The blood of sinners that we didn't reach, we will be held accountable for that. Okay. Also, we will be held accountable for those that backslid, those that we could have rescued, that put forth effort. If we have been a little bit more diligent or spiritual in tune, or spiritually active, more prayerful, more committed to reaching out to people or sympathizing with them. So that's another area that we're going to be held accountable. Those backslidden people that we didn't take time to even call, reach, encourage, or to pursue. Backslidden, we've got to deal with them. You know, sometimes we take the attitude, you know, they can come just like me. They know that Wednesday night is Bible study night. They know Monday night is what, prayer night. So why should I be taking my time calling them when they already know this?
Is something wrong with that? Well,
the Bible says that.
No, I'm just asking.
That's a part of discipleship, and I think that God holds us for what? Not only getting people in the church, but helping to what? Getting them established in the church. Luke 14:27. Got a revelation here.
Whosoever
doeth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. All right, that's good. All right.
Well, now, I have another question.
That's good, Brother Sonny, because if people that don't want to pay the price, sometimes we just feel like it's just too much of a burden to do all of the things that Jesus called us to do. Just to have to go through too many changes.
Okay.
It doesn't leave enough time for me to do what I want to do.
All right.
Okay.
Back up. Let's rewind. What does it mean to be accountable?
All right. What does it mean to be accountable? All right.
We use that word loosely, I think, accountable, which is true.
Mm-hmm.
But what does that really mean when you say accountable?
Okay.
For some, you know, accountable for soul, accountable for this, accountable for this. Does that mean? Okay. Well, just what does that mean?
Well, when Scripture says
I want somebody else to mention.
Okay, anybody else? She just won't eat up my time. She already knows the answer. Okay, she wants to know what it means to be accountable.
But somebody may not know, though. I mean, somebody, I think that's important because sometimes when you feel accountable for something, you feel total responsibility accountable. But if sometimes it's not total responsibility,
right, totally.
Accountability. So. Mm-hmm. I think that's a valuable question.
All right, anybody
am I right?
Got a quick answer? Because we don't want to spend a whole lot of time. We've got a long ways to go. She says it's very important.
It is important.
It is important.
Yeah. Thank you, Sister
Shirley. Is it a matter of planting the seed?
Okay, plant the seed. Okay.
We plant the seed, let someone else do whatever else comes watering and so forth.
All right, that's a good point. Okay. That's very good.
Okay.
Anybody
so
else?
So in other words, you're saying you don't have to do it all one person then.
Okay.
Because we can't save them, we can only lead them to
okay.
Them.
Okay. The scripture says don't withhold good from them to what? For whom it is good when it's in the power of your hand to do it. See, everything, you're not going to have the power to do everything for everybody. Somebody else is going to have to do what certain things, right? You only do what's in the power of your hand. Do it.
Right. And we have to be ever cognizant of the fact that you plant the seeds,
mm-hmm.
and then he says someone else will have the audience gives an increase,
mm-hmm.
that your responsibility is discharged once you planted the seeds,
mm-hmm.
if that's what, you know, they come across your path.
Mm-hmm.
But that person has to make the decision. The Holy
mm-hmm.
Spirit will look on that individual. Mm-hmm. And if they don't make a decision, that doesn't mean that you're accountable for them not making a decision, you know, because you can plant a seed, you can water, and they can still walk away and say, I'm not ready yet.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want this.
Okay, well, sometimes you have to follow the Holy Spirit as
mm-hmm.
to how far to go and how, you know, when to pull back and to hang in there. Sometimes we need to hang in there when we what? We pull back. Sometimes we need to pull back when we need to what? Hang in there. Okay, she's quiet now. Let's move on. Okay, the third category, we said that encouraging those that are what? Whole and fast. People that are in the faith and they are consistent, they are committed, they are established. We need to make a practice of what? Encouraging them so that they won't faint or fall by the wayside. So there are three categories, and that's very important. That sometimes you look at Sister Pearl. Sister Pearl don't need no encouragement. Look how, amen, she's been around here ever since the ministry started almost. She don't need nothing. And sometimes we don't have a clue as to what's going on in her life. She might be right at the verge of what? Throw it in the towel. Well, I hope she's not. Okay. So I think that there are various ways that we can encourage one another. Whole and tight. You know, one thing that we can do, we can always encourage people that the Lord lead us to encourage. Sometimes people might share things with you, benefit, bless you. You need to what? You need to share it. Because suppose a minister or teacher goes a whole year and nobody say anything, and he's consistently sowing, and everybody just said, well, he's supposed to do that. And they don't ever mention anything. You might be almost at the point of throwing in the towel. Like sometimes the way I feel, like throwing in the towel. Just throw it. Hey, but these people don't care. Now, you know, they don't ever say anything. they never verbalize anything that you do. I mean, some of them, but there are about three or four people that always keep me going. If I don't hear from those two or three people, I just feel like, oh. And I'm going to confess this, y'all, keep it to yourself. It's between me and you and the gatepost.
And you're going to tell it.
I'm going to tell it. All right? Don't tell nobody else. Okay, like on Sunday, when I preach, there are people that will come up. There are certain ones that will always tell you, Pastor, you know, I really, really appreciate your word. It really, really blesses me. All right? But the one that probably blesses me more, Sister Hill, she very seldom forget. Probably one time out of a year, she might just say, she got things in her mind, she got, you know, things going. And she might just forget it. And I just be kind of uneasy in my spirit. And I just be kind of be waiting for her to come, you know, maybe before dinner, after dinner, sometime in the evening. And she never comes around, but that little something never goes away. I said, man, I just messed up today. I didn't do nothing. Oh, gosh. I just feel like just going through the floor. But whenever she gets to the word, all she said, by the way, sometimes it's weird in the evening. By the way. that's the thing that puts the icing on the cake. So y'all don't know how important it is to just give a person a good word in due season. You never know. Amen. Like Brother Travis, you know, and Brother Williams, it's always good to just, you know, periodically just say that you're doing a good job, really receive, it's been a blessing to me, and you've really helped me or benefited me. The message was great. Because, see, you'd be surprised of how many pastors are throwing in the towels today. You'd be surprised.
I read an article.
Okay, you read an article.
I read an article. That nationwide, 50 to 70 churches close every week. Every week. 50 to 70. That's a lot. Every week. That means if it's 70, and multiply that by 4 weeks, that's about almost 300 churches a month that's closing. And just because of, you know, discouragement, and people stop coming and stop giving and blah, blah, blah. And it just fades away.
That's the reason why there's so much discouragement from to leaders, is because many times members, you know, I know that sometimes it's on the leadership too, but a lot of sometimes it's on the membership. Sometimes they won't do what they're supposed to do. And it's just very frustrating, and you can't harp on things and tell people that they're not doing this, you know. Sometimes you just go along as long as you can, and sometimes there comes a breaking point. You just walk away and throw your towel and just forget it all. Okay, so that is the reason. Now, we have mentioned now that we're to help reach out. We're to reach out to the lost. We're to be concerned about people that are slipping back, people that are not showing up, people that's not consistent, people that's not here tonight. That's a good test of who is backsliding. I know some have schedules, and even if people have schedules that do not permit them to come on Wednesday night, they're not getting what they need to get, and they are on the backs. They are declining too. There's no way that you can miss all of these sessions that's designed. See, these sessions like this are designed to build people up, to keep you encouraged. I mean, there are things that I have said tonight that have probably calls you to see things in a different light. Sometimes you have to be reminded of the same things, what? Over, 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 and over. And whenever you do not, whenever you're not exposed to that, there's going to be a tendency for you to begin to what? Wane in your devotion, in your commitment, and in your responsibility to these three categories that we have just mentioned. Okay, so the lost, the backslidden, of those that's slipping back, those that's falling, gradually falling by the wayside. That's the reason why I think on Sunday evening, maybe at 5 o'clock, I probably need to do some follow through with it. I might even do it Saturday. All I have to do, Sunday. Those that do not make it to Wednesday night, we will reach out again on Sunday evening. at 5. Let them come for an hour. Amen. So we will come up with that. So if you miss, some say, I don't feel like coming on Wednesday night. Well, you come on Sunday evening. You just can't let you off scot-free. Some people say, well, if I don't make it Wednesday, which ain't no big deal. See, that's wrong. I don't remember, since I've been saved, where I missed hardly that many services or hardly any when I was really, in my initial stages of my Christian walk. When I was working away from home, I was teaching school, being 40 miles away, 50 miles away, I always ended up at a church on Tuesday night or Wednesday night. I always did that. Friday night I was back home, so I was at the church again. Okay, so
just what did that do for you?
Well, you can see what you can see tonight where I am.
Well, no.
I can go back.
I wanted you to say that,
Now, let me just tell you the difference. My cousin, I just visited with him. He's a policeman, retired policeman, in Little Rock, and he's probably around 68, and we were very close friends. And neither one of us got saved when we were young. I was 21 years old. He never got saved. And even to this day, he's not saved. Oh, he is sad. He is sad, sad, sad. He's gone through, he's gone through divorce, lost his family. And I don't know how many girlfriends and women he got now. He got them. But he's not right. I mean, I can talk with him, and his mind ain't right. You know, so when people do not make that commitment. And it took, I believe the only way out, the reason I got saved is because I got really, this woman started prophesying over me. And I was always scared of the saints. When the saints got in the spirit like Sunday, sometime when we have services like Sunday, the gifts will begin to work. And God will begin to use people to say things through them. And the things that God says through them, when they're really in the spirit, sometimes will really scare you. I mean, it will cause a lot of fear. And I was always, I knew enough. I had enough fear of God when I was growing up in the church. I knew that when saints got in the spirit and began to prophesy, I knew that was real. And if they said death or something in specific, I knew that it was going to what? It was going to happen. So this lady came to me, and I was casually seeking the Lord, and a lot of people seek the Lord for 30 years, never get filled with the Holy Spirit, just casually. They don't put nothing in it. And that's the way I was going about it, because I grew up in the church, and I just didn't want to open my mouth real wide and break through all of that deadness and fleshly, all of those fleshly barriers. I just didn't want to do that. Because I knew that people would be looking down my throat, and I'll be looking and spitting and, looking ugly and funny and crazy. People can tease you, they can do a whole lot of stuff to embarrass you if you just let go and let God have his way. Because you're going to break down. Next Sunday, most times you're going to weep and cry when the Spirit really gets you real good. And sometimes people don't want to place themselves in a position where they can be subjective to what? Embarrassing. And that's the reason why we just hold it in. When you need to be what? Let it go. Amen. My Sunday, well, I just hung in there. Several of you just, amen, kept praying until the thing just opened up. Heaven opened. But it's not easy to get past your flesh. And sometimes you just have to what? When that sister said death, because I didn't know what she was talking about, but she did say death, and I was scared of death. And I always listened to that word when saints got happy and started prophesying. I always listened. If they said something about death, I knew somebody was going to die. I knew it because I had seen it so many times. And when this lady came over me, it was only 4 of us in the room. 2 of us unsaved and 2 were saved that were praying for me. It was only 4, and when she said death, it wasn't but 2 that received the Lord. That wasn't too hard to figure out. And my buddy, it seemed like he was much further along than I was, much more serious. He was trying to get himself in a position to marry the love of his life. She said she wouldn't marry him until he got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. So he was trying harder than I was. And I was the one that always held back. I, you know, growing up in the Holiness Church all that time, I never opened myself up to let the Lord save me and fill me with the Holy Spirit. All of my sisters and brothers, 13, 14, 15, all were saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. But I had all of this pride, and they used to call me Cat Daddy. Like Brother Al, you had that lift in your walk. So, on the college campus, they called me Cat Daddy. I had that pride. I didn't want to be humiliated, you know, by, you know, something that, you know, I didn't want to be embarrassed. But when that sister said, death, 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 death today, I said, wait. Wait a minute. Who is she talking about? And that struck a note in my heart. I said, man, then she just said, death in this church. Death today. In other words, I thought she was saying somebody was going to die, and they're going to die. Because I had been dreaming. I said, the way of a transgressor is always hard. When your mama's praying, you know, I had a praying mother. They used to fast and pray. Everybody in my family were intercessors. And when she said death, death, death today in this church, so I just felt like I was going to die. I had come to the end. I had been dreaming for years that I died before I got saved and I went straight to hell. I've been dreaming that over and over and over and over. And you definitely heard it from the pulpit. Amen. So when she said that, the only thing that clicked with me that I was going to die and die today in the church. And I made this conclusion. It didn't take intelligent person to figure this out. She says, today, somebody's going to die. That's what I thought she was saying. So I said, if I'm going to die and die today, I'm going to put forth some effort. I'm going to open my mouth and get saved before I die. And I opened my mouth and I cried out to the Lord. This is something that many of us don't do. We just don't put enough in it to get beyond our flesh. See, everybody Sunday could have got a major breakthrough if they had opened their mouth and put a little forth. Brother Williams always said, let the voice of your praise be heard. And most times you have to you can't hardly hear, you almost have to have a microphone to hear anything coming out a lot of times. And so I just opened my mouth, I just, as wide as I could, loud as I could, and I began to praise the Lord with all my heart. And usually when you open your mouth and praise the Lord with everything you got, although you don't feel nothing, sometimes it feels like your inside is about to come out and you're not getting nowhere. But when I did that, something broke and the joy of the Lord was released in my heart. And I would say in 10 or 15 minutes, I was praying in the Holy Ghost. And continued for about 2 hours. And after all said and done, the Lord worked me over real good. Then she interpreted her prophecy. She said, death today, spiritual death. Spiritual death. Spiritual death is in the church. I said, oh, everybody knows. Half of these people in this church are spiritually dead.
It was too late.
Now, if God had not used that particular method to get me to open up and cry out because of my pride, I could be just like my cousin in Little Rock, 68, 69, never been saved. Came up in a holiness church. He was at every service too. Never been saved. And he lives next door to his sister. His sister saved him with the Holy Spirit. But he's not saved. No wife, no his family. He got kicked out of his relationship. And I don't know how many other relationships he's had in the interim period. But he is just sad. And I'm not even sure. I think that the Lord dealt with me, the Lord said, if you would just take some time with him, you will be able to get him saved. So I believe that there are certain people that God can place in your path that can really deal with people that are very difficult. Okay, so that's my little spiel, but it took that for me. And it might take some spiritual gift and operation to get some of us broken through on Sunday morning. That's the reason why those that surrender to the Lord, let the Lord use you so that what? God can give you something in the spirit that will help to what? Break those barriers that's holding a whole lot of what? Saints captive. Saints have been held captive. Very saints, few saints can really pray and get a full release. Until that brokenness come and they just cry and weep and get that full joy and that warmth feeling and begin to pray in the spirit very fluently. I mean,